But yeah, thank you for having me. And my talk is about software engineering. Unfortunately, I went over to the dark side a few years ago. I don't code professionally anymore. It's just a hobby now, sadly. I wish it wasn't, but that's how it is. So the talk is more philosophical and software engineering. Yeah. So hi, this is me. As the introduction said, I work for GOJEK. I do a bunch of different things at GOJEK. I've done pretty much everything over the last 3.5 years while we've been scaling the organization. I've done recruiting, I've done HR, I've done sales, I've done marketing. My colleagues from the marketing team, some of you may have met outside. We also do data eng over the years. And I also have the pleasure of working on a bunch of community stuff over the years with some very good people. I've been doing this for 14 odd years now, professionally. As a hobbyist, I started coding when I was 6 and carried that through, and then last 14 years I've been working professionally. I've done, you know, 4 startups, 2 jobs, had 1 exit. I've consulted across a bunch of different scales. And as I said, you know, I help organize, like I'm part of the nonprofit that helps organize RubyConf India, GopherCon India, and DevOps Days India. So I've done many different things, and the reason this is relevant is because what I'm going to talk about next is probably one of the most difficult concepts that that I've had to internalize. I don't think I've necessarily internalized it very well. And a lot of that perspective did not exist when I was focused purely on dev. And a lot of that perspective came as I did different roles over time. I've lost the screen's gone blank. Can I? That's fine. I'll just use this. That's fine. Some of the stuff I do on this side, the fact that this talk is also heavily based on the fact that I'm into philosophy and reading, which is a good combination to pontify on topics like this. And my side hobby, because you know you've got to have this silly side hobby that you call out, is motorcycles. So that's me. Just the quick this thing. I think that's the only bright image. So now I'm at GOJEK, where you know, I'm one of the, you know, as we jokingly call it, I'm one of the Sith. I went over to the dark side. All the people who do the real work are the Jedi, and you know, there's a few of us, myself included, that are the Sith. Our job is to make sure that everybody else can continue to do real work, and we don't do real work anymore. So a little bit of context around the scaling, because this talk is primarily around scaling engineering and the challenges you face that are not obviously technical, right? So this is just a quick context, a recap, to give you a sense of the kind of scaling challenges you've gone through. In January 2015, when GOJEK started out, we were about, the organization must have been about 5 engineers total, and you're talking about 15,000 orders a month. By April, it had gone up 6x. This is the time that we started working with GOJEK. At that time, we were doing about, thank you so much, much appreciated. So April, we were doing about 100K per month, and the team had grown to about 20 people. This is when you know, me and my colleagues started working with GOJEK. October, we were looking at, you know, 166x bump up. You'll note that the icons underneath represent the products which are being added. So what you'll notice is this trend where, on average, we're adding a new product to the lineup about every month. So jump forward a year. We're about 100 people. We're post-unicorn. You're looking at 2300x scaling. Jump forward a year yet again. We're still under 250. And you're looking at 5600x scale. And this is the last number I'm allowed to talk about. It's gone up further from here, where you're looking at 6000x, right? So to give you a sense of proportion here, from September 2015 to September 2016, which were, you know, probably the hardest part of the journey, we were looking at scaling up the stack by 3 orders of magnitude, while reducing defects and downtimes by 3 orders of magnitude, while launching a new product every month on average, with the overall engineering organization being less than 80 people, right? So that was kind of the forced growth and the pain that we went through. And this is something that we're especially proud of, right? even today, we're still ultra lean. We're doing about 600,000 orders per month per engineer, and that's a ratio that we keep an eye on. And that's completed orders, right? This is not one of those numbers where you talk about, you know, attempted orders or something in between, the actual completed orders. Now, this is the context. This is to add some legitimacy to a suit coming here and talking about engineering scaling, right? And here are some of the hard truths that were reinforced. And this is stuff that you know, we'd learned out of the textbook, but this was reinforced really, really hard through the journey. And a lot of my talk is going to be me quoting some phenomenal people and then, you know, just counting on their stuff. So the biggest cause of failure in software-intensive systems is not technical failure, it's building the wrong thing. Right? Definitely true. We learned this the hard way. The number of products or features that we started out and ended up killing is ridiculous. Like, I think we must have exceeded like a 30% or 40% rate at which we tried things and then just dropped them because it wasn't working out. The other thing that we learned is most software projects fail. It's in the nature of software, and this is one of my favorite quotes. It's a very, you know, Fred Brooks has got some legendary books and papers that are worth reading. Most of his talk is based on that, and this is a very complicated statement, right? Program maintenance is an entropy increasing process. And even its most skillful execution only delays the subsidence of the system into unfixable obsolescence. I honestly believe he was trying to rhyme when he wrote this, right? But what this boils down to is the default nature of software is that it goes to shit. This is the inherent nature of software, right? We our job is to run a defensive battle against entropy. The next truth is that scaling software in prod is hard, right? And as a consequence of these truths, the next quote, we hear desperate cries for a silver bullet, something to make software costs drop as rapidly as computer hardware costs do. Not only are there no silver bullets now in view, the very nature of software makes it unlikely that there will be any. Which means that there is no simple solution to this. This is the reality of this profession that we have signed up for. That the more successful we are, the worse our code bases will get, the worse our stacks will get. And in a large measure, our job is to slow down that degradation. And the process, the tools that we have to slow down that degradation, there is no single tool, there is no single approach that will solve the problem for us. So there is no silver bullet solution to scaling. This is a truth. But when you start out, it doesn't start that way, right? When you start out, and I'm going to use startups as an example, but this is generally true for most software projects. Startups is an easy basis. Remember the good old days? Small team, everyone sat together, very few prod defects, features shipped in days, morale was consistently high. Downtimes you could just root cause in 5 minutes. You look at a couple of graphs and you know what's wrong. Eventually you almost build an intuitive understanding of what is the root cause of an issue. And as you scale, you seem to get unluckier and unluckier, right? Like bad stuff starts to happen. Defects rise, downtimes go up, good people leave. Features that took, you know, days now start taking months or years. And root causes become very hard to decipher, right? And this becomes the common question. Everyone starts asking this question. Why is nothing moving? Nobody can answer this question. From the junior-most engineer to the CTO, no one has an answer to this question. Everyone's working hard. This is the interesting part, right? There's no question about the effort that's going in. Everyone's working hard, they're pulling their weight, but nothing is moving, nobody knows why. When does this change happen? You know, some of you, you may not have gone through this transition, some of you may have gone through this transition. What I wanted to sort of start off with is, when does this transition happen? And in order to sort of pinpoint the transition and move on from there, I just want to sort of map out the trajectories of such projects along a couple of different axes. So since I'm using startups as a basis, let's talk in terms of a fundraising strategy first. So if you're looking at an early stage startup, right? you're probably raising, you're less than $1 million raised, and you're running a monolithic stack. By the way, if you're not running a monolithic stack at this stage, you're massively over-engineered, right? Your code needs to be shit, right? If your code isn't shit, then something is wrong. You're not iterating fast enough, and you're over-engineering. So a little sidebar there. You start scaling up. You go series A to C. You're less than $1 billion. And you're running synchronous microservices. This is fairly textbook these days. You scale up a little bit more, and you're looking at async. And then you go start doing the really fancy stuff. You go distributed. You have a bunch of PhDs who are doing really, really hard computer science. And you're talking about, you know, organizations like Google or Ethereum or Amazon, right? So this is in terms of the tech. If you look at it in terms of people, because remember, Conway's law tells us that if you're scaling code, it's tightly coupled with how you're scaling your organization. So let's talk about headcount. When you're at the monolith, your pre-traction, you're probably just one team. Family-sized is how I like to call this, right? Then you start growing, and you're looking at 1 to 10 teams. Grow it a little bit more. At this point, you're probably into a sustained hockey stick, 10 to 100 teams, and then you go, you know, Amazon, Google scale, more than 100 teams, really big. Somewhere along the way, what happens? And this is typically somewhere between family and post-family sized. Things become complex, right? You know, the thing about family sized is interesting because at a family size scale, your understanding of what's going on is intuitive. Nobody needs to teach you management, so to speak. Right, the management of software, the management of people, it doesn't matter. You intuitively know the right thing to do because we all understand what it is to live in a family. So at family sized, everything is obvious, self-evident, and intuitive. But a scaling up of a software entity is not merely a repetition of the same elements in larger size. It is necessarily an increase in the number of different elements. In most cases, the elements interact with each other in some non-linear fashion. And the complexity of the whole increases much more than linearly. So what this means is, you know, when we look at traditional systems and try to build analogies to software, the limitation of those analogies lies in the fact that most large systems that you see that are not software have a lot of very, very similar components. If you're talking about a jet, you know, a plane, a car, pick any such example that you would commonly see that we draw analogies from. The underlying components are largely standardized. Now, we talk about software as though we have standardized our stuff, but we have not. The truth is that most of our components are wildly differing. Their interactions with each other increases the number of differences. And that change increases the number of possible permutations exponentially. So this talk really is about the complexity of our medium. We all work in this medium called software. This is how we express ourselves. This is how we build businesses. This is how we make things happen. And there are attributes of this medium, this abstract medium, that it is important to understand. And the complexity of the medium is probably, in my opinion, one of the single most challenging and important aspects to grok. Now, when I say abstract medium, it's also important to call out what we mean by this, right? We throw this word around so much, abstraction, abstraction, abstraction. The thing about something that's abstract is that it doesn't have a physical manifestation. You can't look at it. You can't touch it. You can't easily describe it. Any attempt to represent it is inherently a lossy compression. If you try to draw out boxes on a whiteboard, you've lost something. If you look at the code that's running on the system, you've lost something, right? If you look at wireframes, if you look at any other representation, and this is interesting, right? I'm making this distinction between code and software. Code is not software. Code is a projection of software. Software is abstract, right? Those are not the same thing. Now, when you start working with something that you cannot see, you cannot touch, you cannot adequately represent without loss of information, and that something has complexity that scales non-linearly, now you have a real problem. And what is that real problem? All of this is just a polite way of saying that in software, very bad things happen very suddenly, right? It's non-linear progress. So everything will seem fine, and then you'll hit an inflection point, and you suddenly drown in defects, or your velocity drops almost to zero. Something like that happens. Complexity is the root cause of the vast majority of problems with software today. The primary status of complexity as the major cause comes simply from the fact that being able to understand a system is a prerequisite for avoiding all of them. And of course, it is this which complexity destroys, right? What this means is that we cannot really understand what is going on with software. We tend to ignore this because we abstract this away. But the truth is, a simple hello world, if you try to encompass it in every layer of abstraction, all the way down to the hardware level, down to the CPU level, down to, you know, go as far down as you want, there's probably, I don't know, several thousand layers of abstraction in there. There is no human being alive who could comprehend all of it at once. And if you're going to avoid problems, you need to understand some, you need to understand the system to avoid those problems. Now, what we're saying is what we do is inherently not understandable, which means, because it is inherently not understandable, it is impossible for us to completely avoid problems. The complexity destroys our ability to grasp what is going on. Now, all of you have had a difficult time debugging something. I doubt there's anyone in the room that hasn't spent hours trying to debug something and gotten frustrated. The reason that happens is this. Managing software complexity is essential to scaling. At the highest level of abstraction, if you want to be able to scale a stack and scale a team and scale an organization, tackling complexity at that level of abstraction is extremely crucial. And the first step is to identify which pieces of that complexity are you going to focus on. What aspects of the complexity are essential? And I'm using actually technical terms here, right? I'm quoting some very famous papers on the topic, so this is not an accident. Note that the definition of essential is deliberately more strict than the common usage. Specifically, when we use the term essential, we will mean strictly essential to the user's problem, as opposed to, perhaps, essential to some specific implemented system, or even essential to software in general. Right? Oops, sorry. So essential complexity is that which, even in an ideal world, the team will have to be concerned with. Accidental complexity is everything else. Now, what this means is everything that we do, that we talk about, that we're so passionate about, compilers, interpreters, continuous integration stacks, new programming language paradigms, these are all accidental. These things don't matter when it comes to the actual value that we're trying to create. If you want to book a cab, it does not matter to you whether that code was written in Java, whether it was functional programming, whether that team uses continuous integration or not, and what their unit test coverage is. That stuff matters to us, not to the people who actually benefit from using the product. And so all of that stuff is accidental complexity. Just imagine if we could ship software without having to deal with all of that. We have all of that in existence as tools to help us manage complexity, and all of it is accidental. And it's important to keep this in mind, because otherwise you get sucked into this mindset of focusing on all of the accidental complexity around and missing out on the essential. Software engineering strategy must focus teams on addressing essential complexity while measuring and minimizing the cost of accidental complexity. And this is one of the hardest, so easy to say, but one of the hardest things to do when you're building stuff is to constantly ask yourself the question, which of the problems, which of the complexity that I'm solving is essential and which is accidental? How many folks here are familiar with the term yak shaving? Right? Yak shaving, for me, is a classic example of our addiction to accidental complexity. It's pleasurable. I enjoy doing it. I know you do too. But it's important, and there's a reason we apply that label to it, yak shaving. The label yak shaving is there to remind us that this stuff isn't the point. It may be fun, but it's not the point. Many of the classic problems of developing software products derive from this essential complexity and its nonlinear increases in size. So when you start solving problems, you have to understand that problems breed problems. Complexity breeds complexity. There's a reason why, you know, and this is a common thing that I come across in conversation, right? People will ask me, why don't you allow any programming language at GOJEK? At GOJEK, currently, our core stack runs on top of 6 languages, and it's restricted. We do skunkworks, we do stuff on the side with other languages, but you can't just put any language into prod, right? You can use Java, you can use JRuby, you can use Golang, and you can use Clojure. And on the front end, you use Kotlin or you use Swift. And anything else has to go through a process of validation and justification before you put it into prod. The reason is that that adds to accidental complexity. I know that it is more fun to spike out a new stack on top of, say, Crystal, or, you know, pick something that you'd really enjoy working on, but that's not in that list. But the point is, when you put that into production, you add massive amounts of accidental complexity. Who's going to worry about the uptime? Who's going to worry about how to run RCAs on that stuff? Who's going to worry about how to debug that stuff in prod? Right? I believe the hard part of building software to be the specification, design, and testing of this conceptual construct, not the labor of representing it and testing the fidelity of the representation. We still make syntax errors, to be sure, but they are fuzz compared to the conceptual errors in most systems. The hard thing that we do, the truly hard thing that we do that creates value for other people is the software. And yet, our instinct is to focus on all of the representations of that software. We end up focusing on which compiler, which language, right? And that's important. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying it's not important, but I'm saying it's less important than focusing on the essential. Solutions to essential complexity breed exponentially more accidental. This is just inherent. You know, here we are just trying to get a cab for somebody, and the next thing you know, you've got like 40,000 VMs in prod. Oops, right? So every time you solve a key scaling issue, you have side effects. This is inherent. And if you're not paying careful attention to it, those side effects breed more side effects, and this is a runaway process that increases exponentially. Given that in the real world, not all possible ways are practical, the implication is that any real development will need to contend with some accidental complexity. Because the question then becomes, why can't we just not create accidental complexity? And the answer is, you can aspire to that in an ideal universe, but this is not an ideal universe. And so you cannot avoid creating accidental complexity. Otherwise, we'd all still be writing code in assembly, right? This is my opinion, right? Purely my opinion. But you'll see this term being bandied about frequently all over, right? It's hip to say this, 10x programmers, 10x programmers. And you'll keep seeing all these debates about what is a 10x programmer? This is my 2 cents. A 10x programmer is not someone who's smarter or knows more programming languages or any of those things. A 10x programmer is someone who's able to keep a ruthless eye on accidental complexity and to continuously mitigate it, often at the cost of their own entertainment and pleasure. Right? This is to me what a 10x programmer is. Right? Now, when we make decisions, it's extremely important to factor in the cost of accidental complexity. For example, and I'm going to go completely off the reservation here and talk about seemingly, like, not directly technical, directly code-related problems. Programmers are essential, right? We're still not at a point where we have machine learning models that can churn out code, so, you know, we're not redundant yet. But when we add more programmers to a system in an attempt to build more and more complex software, what we inherently do is to add accidental complexity in terms of communication overhead. This is why, again, for us, one of the rules we have is if a team starts to slow down, what you do is you take a pair off the team. If it still doesn't speed up, you take another pair off the team. And our experience consistently has been that reducing the number of engineers on the team until the velocity picks up is the best way to address the problem. And then once the velocity is picked up again, you carefully add programmers back onto the team. Why is this? Because while adding programmers to scale up is essential, the communication overhead and all of the design coordination overhead is accidental. And of course, there's a great quote for this, right? Very pithy one, something that we keep emailing to non-technical managers. Adding manpower to a late software project makes it later. It's probably the, you know, it always amuses me how the rest of the quotes are so verbose, and this one quote is so pithy, right? Another example, choosing to use chat as a primary communication tool across the company. Communication is essential. We can't do this stuff if we're not talking to each other. But what is the unintended side effect of chat? Continuous interruption? Right? Like you're zoned in, you're trying to write some code and bing, right? There's that notification right there. How do you zone in and build stuff if that's happening? But does that mean that you throw communication out of the window? And I've seen that proposed in some places, right? But that's throwing the baby out with the bathwater. This is a classic example where if you do not, like you need chat. You're not going to do this without chat. But if you do not apply extremely rigorously policed rules around how chat is used and when it can be used and whom can you communicate with on chat and at what time and at what frequency, you create ridiculous amounts of accidental complexity. I think this is one of the single biggest productivity killers I've seen. And yet, communication is essential. Right? This is my little joke, right? Adding manpower to a late software project and then interrupting them constantly with Slack mentions makes it even later still. Another, you know, sort of strategic example. Choosing a suboptimal stack because hiring for it is easy. I've seen this, I end up having this conversation so many times. Hey, should I really be hiring Golang devs? And I'm picking that because, you know, I'm at a Golang conference. But you could substitute in any, you know, really, you know, good language in there and compare it with any other language that is easy to hire for. And you will see this conversation pop up every single time. Hey, this is, the, you know, this is, I don't know what the state in Singapore is, but in India, for example, the you know, people generally perceive that hiring folks with a lot of Java or PHP experience is easy. And now, of course, we're all damned with, you know, JavaScript, right? So these things have become hugely popular, and then people are like, hey, you know, it's super easy to hire JavaScript devs or PHP devs. But is JavaScript or PHP the right stack for your problem? And is it really the wise thing to do to optimize for hiring, ease of hiring, over the productivity that you gain from picking the right stack? Right? So again, you know, trying to hire people is essential, but the side effects of that on your stack and your productivity, accidental. Yet another example. Choosing to scale our stuff horizontally. Hardware limitations make this essential. We're the days of vertical scaling are long over. But most people dive into this, and I'm happy to admit that in the early days, this really blindsided us as well, right? But the cost of managing, in terms of you know, coordination, automation, the cost of managing thousands or millions of boxes is just something no one considers, right? So we're like all into horizontal scaling, and the next thing you know, you've got like 40,000 boxes, and you don't know where they came from. And then you try to garbage collect them, and every box you kill, and three more pop up somewhere, and you don't know, well, you know, what's going on. Forcing tired programmers to code. Deadlines are essential. Sometimes there's competition, right? Sometimes there's a market reality that means there is a real deadline. Like, I'm not even talking about the fake deadlines, right, that are so common in our industry, but a real, genuine, legit deadline. But the accidental cost in bad architecture, tech debt, and burnout is just ignored. So don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that deadlines are bad. Fake deadlines are bad. But real deadlines do exist. It's a thing. But if you're not focusing on managing the accidental complexity that comes out of having those deadlines, then problems multiply. Any one of these things single-handedly can cause bad luck at scale. Put them together and it's a complete killer, right? Many distracted devs stepping on each other's toes, proliferations of bugs because the language is hard to debug, infrastructure that's unmanageable, and then someone will tell you, hey, you know, you need DevOps, right? So in summary, most companies, in my opinion, fail to scale due to self-inflicted accidental complexity, or rather more specifically, due to a lack of focus on managing the accidental complexity, right? Most scaling problems are accidental. There are essential scaling problems, but most of the pain and most of the stuff that you deal with when scaling up an organization or a stack stem from accidental complexity. There is no single development in either technology or management technique which by itself promises even one order of magnitude improvement within a decade in productivity, in reliability, in simplicity. So this really is the core. This is the long form of no silver bullet, right? There is no good solution to any of this. This is extremely dependent on each and every one of us throwing non-trivial amounts of brain cycles at trying to segregate what is essential, what is accidental, and then figuring out how do I mitigate what happens when it's accidental. There's no one process, you know, like, I don't know how many of you in this room have been had the pleasure of being in a situation where someone has told you, we will adopt Scrum, it shall fix everything. Right? Sounds familiar? There is no silver bullet. In summary, I would say that if there's one takeaway, it would be this. Distinguish between the what is essential and what is accidental. And if you're a Sith, right, if you've gone to the dark side, if your job involves making sure that the people who do real work continue to do real work, then you should help teams focus on the essential. And you should do everything in your power to focus on the essential, right? And you need to spend inordinate amounts of effort, because remember, the complexity is exponential. It's very hard to convey exactly how much effort you need to put into managing this, right? Because it's exponential. It will just sneak up on you, and before you know it, it's the biggest thing you're dealing with. And remember, there is no silver bullet. There is no silver bullet. You are going to have to solve this every single time from first principles, using a multitude of techniques that nobody can predict upfront. So yeah, that's my talk. Thank you. That's fine, we can just take it straight from the audience, no problem. Okay, yeah. Okay, question number one, can I get your slide? Yes, you can, no problem. I will be publishing it. I mean, this versions of this are already published, and I will publish it. You'll be able to get a link from it off my website. Oops, sorry. Next question, how do you know what is the right stack? What is right anyway? Ah, deep philosophical question. Now, the problem with answering this question is, again, this is a silver bullet type answer, right? Like, there is no silver bullet. There is no such thing as the right stack. Our approach to it at GOJEK has been to have a mix and match of stacks available that broadly addresses every permutation that's reasonable. I think, for example, you've already heard me mention which languages and stacks we run. But one thing that I think we're missing, for example, is a statically typed functional programming stack, right? But the bottom line is, I don't think there's any such thing as a right stack. What is a right stack is whatever it is that allows you to scale up sustainably without burnout, without spikes and defects. And you need to have a willingness to change the stack as the times change. Even for us, when we started out, we used a lot of Java and JRuby, and quite frankly, Java and JRuby are sunsetting for us, and Golang and Clojure are on the rise. And that's fine. I think what's important is not to lock yourself into one thing, but to have a pretty clear understanding of how things are moving, what is better for you as your system scales, and to pick that. How many of these questions should I take? I mean, there are several. Is Linus Torvalds a 10x programmer? Wow, okay, that's an interesting question. I don't know. I don't think I dare answer that question. When GOJEK launched in another country, it used a different application name. Why? Is it because you have a problem handling I18N and localization? Okay, this one you should catch me. This is a business answer. This is not a technical answer, so I'll take it offline. Do you encourage flat desk culture where random people come and chat non-related stuff? Interesting question. We've actually gone through three iterations on this. Me personally, I really like an open office. But at the same time, I completely understand, and I experience it myself, that the focus that you get in an open office is limited. So what we actually ended up doing is now we have three variations across different floors of our office plan. We've got one floor that's completely open office. We've got one that's a blend where the center is open, but you've got a lot of enclosed spaces around the open area where you can, you know, up to four people can go in and you know, it's quiet and it's soundproofed. And then we've got one which is not cubicles, but is largely closed out with a heavy focus on blocking out line of sight and blocking out sound without actually feeling claustrophobic. So as an individual or as a team, and depending on what you're working on, you can decide which floor you want to be on, because I think the jury is still out and it's very subjective as to, you know, which one it is that works. So our solution to this has just been, you know, offer options and let each individual decide. So yeah, I think that was most of the questions. I don't want to take up too much time. For the others, I'll be around. Please come find me. I'm happy to take questions.